Hi. This presentation is about injustices in water legislation in Africa and the need to move towards a solution which is a hybrid approach to water legislation. It's based on research done, supported by the REACH program, led by Pegasus Institute in collaboration with IMI and in collaboration with the senior water authorities and researchers of Kenya, Uganda, South Africa, Malawi and Zimbabwe, but also in collaboration with a number of international organizations that also worked in other African countries. We did the literature field research, we had two workshops for the policy dialogues, we held webinars and gave a number of presentations, and the outputs were also presented at the Africa Water Week in Gabon last October. And that also created quite some interest in the international social media. Not too surprisingly, because permit systems prevail in 80% of African countries. It's not only those five countries, but what we found is relevant for 80% of African countries that do have permit systems or licenses, also called licenses. For the detailed publications, we refer to a number of internationally peer-reviewed papers, and especially to a practical guide for managers on how such hybrid water use rights systems could look like. So what are the injustices? They take place in a context in which self-supply, so people's own investments in water infrastructure for irrigation, livestock, domestic uses, people's own investments in infrastructure have been there since time immemorial, and we see that they are accelerating. The gravity systems develop with markets, the wetlands are increasingly cultivated, and especially with groundwater pumping, the even buckets, but also the mechanized groundwater pumping, and certainly with the solar energy that is coming. We basically agree with the World Bank that we talk about a revolution already in progress. Water infrastructure is being developed to meet broad-based agricultural growth and improved well-being. Water Witness International made a video in Tanzania that captures the problems of permit systems very well. I'm going to show.
Mimi naitwa Hamis Mohamed Mtungambande, mwenyekiti wa skimu ya Mkula, umoja wa umwagiliaji maji. Skimu ya Mkula ilianza mwaka 1978. Ilianza na takribani watu 10, mpaka sasa tunawanufaika zaidi ya 900. Na tuna tatizo kubwa la maji ambaye tumekwenda kulipia mwaka 2007, tumelipia, tumepata risiti. Vivyo hivyo mwaka 2014 tumekwenda tumelipia tena, tumepata risiti. Sasa kwa hali hii, kama mwenyekiti, naona kabisa kwamba kulingana na hali ya sasa ilivyo, huduma za maji zimepanuka, ninaweza nikakosa huduma hii kwenye kijiji changu au kwenye skimu yangu, wakachukua watu wa eneo lingine. Kwa hiyo ninaomba serikali inisaidie jambo hili ili nipate kibali cha kudumu, skimu yangu ifanye kazi kwa uhakika.
This is a problem that we also see in other countries. So millions of smallholders, irrigating smallholders, are obliged to apply for a permit, but the state just lacks the logistic capacity to process even applications, let alone enforce the conditions. A second injustice has to do with the exemptions, because all these water laws, they set a threshold below which people do not have to apply for a permit. For example, domestic users generally don't require a permit. Microscale productive users just for subsistence, or manual abstraction means those users don't require. These micro users don't require. The big problem now that the legal status of being exempted is weak. If I have am exempted and I have to defend my water rights vis-à-vis a permit holder, well, people don't even know that I exist. So what is the scale that we are talking about? In fact, the number of permits that have been issued in these five countries is a couple of thousand. Interestingly, for Zimbabwe, the 10,799 current permits date mainly from the colonial era. And if we compare that with the estimate of the households that are formally obliged to acquire a permit, let's say 5% of the households uses more water than the threshold, so requires a permit, we talk about 100,000 to 300,000 households who are criminals, who are offenders formally. And yes, three quarters of the rural households will definitely use water for the range of small-scale users. So millions of small-scale, micro-scale water users are exempted from an obligation to apply for a permit, so they don't have any strong legal status, their water use. So then moving to the question, how did Africa end up with a legal system on water rights that is so inappropriate for the continent? We found two reasons. One is that basically the so-called modern water laws are quite similar to what was introduced in the 1920s, especially in Kenya or in Zimbabwe at the time. We don't find much difference between these laws, which means that the laws still serve the purpose of a colonial minority, which starts by saying that all water resources are vested in the colonial rulers and only give permits then to white settlers, and in that way dispossess all African customary informal water uses and water sharing arrangements. That same intent of serving a minority still holds today in terms of entitlements. Which raises then the question how to decolonize African water law. In the 1990s, the second reason is that in the 1990s, integrated water resource management really pushed permit systems, not only in countries that already had permit systems, but even in other countries like South Africa and Uganda. It was seen as international best practice. So what to do? The project proposes a hybrid approach to water rights systems, saying that there are a number of legal tools, there is a range. And let us look at what is the most appropriate in a certain context to reach certain goals in a cost-effective way. And that means that statutory water permits should continue, but only for the high-impact users that need to be regulated and that can be regulated through permits. And all other water users are to be exempted from that obligation and regulated through a range of other tools. And above all, that means that customary water law should finally get an equal legal standing to permits. Informal local investments, local sharing arrangements should finally be recognized with an equal legal standing as permits. Other tool is the prioritization of water use, and rights-based allocation can come in here. And there are other tools like general authorizations, collective permits, etc. So if we depict this key message, comparing the pyramid of many, many small-scale users at the bottom and the few high-impact users at the top, the few high-impact users who use almost all the volume of water. We say strictly enforced permits with clear and enforceable conditions are very important for the few big users. There should be a participatory planning of new investments by high-impact users. They shouldn't pollute, they should pay, etc. Those conditions need to be set and enforced. And then for all the other smaller scale water users, we talk about this range, the suite of other tools. And then lastly, to illustrate how prioritization can look like, we cite the National Water Resources Strategy of South Africa, which on paper gives the following priorities. Unfortunately, it's not implemented, but it shows that this type of policy intentions can definitely take place. And in that National Water Resources Strategy, the ecological and the basic human needs for domestic users are a reserve, is the top priority. International obligations are the second priority, and already then, any water used for poverty eradication, livelihoods, and greater racial and gender equity as a priority, even over the strategic uses, which is the water that is needed mainly for coal-fired power plants for electricity generation. So poverty eradication is a higher priority than electricity generation. And only then the water for other economic purposes with the normal permits would have the priority. So this shows that prioritization and rights-based allocation is already on the agendas and should be promoted. Thank you for your attention.